We are going to be starting with Eric Severson from South Pacific University, who is giving us a paper on nature and the concentration. Eric.
What's up? Good afternoon. So I have to apologize to you. I can't stay after I get my paper and answer some questions. I'm scheduled to get the paper in the SSPWT session. It's already about to happen at the same time. Not because I didn't ask them to give me a little more space between them, the new title of my paper, I don't think I've ever given a paper where the title is the same as the one I proposed, is The Problem with Books Between Sense and Sensibility. We are charged by our conference theme to meditate on what Galileo names the two great books, the Book of Nature and Holy Scripture, or as Mike likes to call it, Holy Writ. In various papers throughout the day, we're examining the philosophical relationship between science and revelation, between our assessments of being and our thoughts of God. For my part, I want to call into question what I think is a phenomenological assumption common to the way that we read both books, in fact, to the way that we read any book. Books are a perfect metaphor, in fact, to demonstrate what I think is a core problem in our philosophical approach to both science and revelation. The evaluation of books is visual, it's intentional, and it's volitional. Books do not present themselves to us forcibly, at least not normally, nor do they invade our personal space unwanted, at least not typically. A book is rarely read accidentally. I don't think I've ever done that, maybe you have. Books are passive friends. They are passive enemies. Our eyes are active. They're active appropriators of the content of books. We go to books to get what we want from them, and our intentionality is wrapped up in the experience of the text. It would be strange to even consider the disentanglement of a book from the intentionality of the reader. My students are required to read from Plato, Kierkegaard, or some other philosopher that makes them cringe, might complain about the task. Yet they read because they choose to read, or at least I wish they would. In the disturbing film A Clockwork Orange, one character, Alex, is strapped to a chair with his eyes pinned open, trapped before a screen, displaying images and an overwhelming cascade of noise. We're not used to this notion of being forced to look at things. Sight is almost always filled with volition. We're able to look away from things that we'd rather not see. I love the show Walking Dead, but I find myself looking away, right? There's so much gruesome content there, and you choose to continue to look at that which you watch. So, you know, you're able to look away, to cover your eyes. Our eyes, our sense of sort of optical vision is very volitional. Just as we're able to put down books that we'd rather not read, there's a directionality then to human experience, especially the optical kind. And I think then to our hermeneutics, or our hermeneutical investigation of these two great books, the Book of Nature and the Book of Revelation. And I think this assumption, this hermeneutical assumption, runs undetected and perhaps blinds us of that which might defy, interrupt, and even overturn our readings of either text. I'm particularly concerned about what this mode of reading does to our thoughts of God and our reflections on human suffering. In this paper, I'm hoping to demonstrate this weakness of philosophical hermeneutics and explore the significance of this oversight for thinking about Christianity's dual moral concern for God and neighbor. Those scenes from Stanley Kubrick's A Clockwork Orange are drawn from the book by Anthony Burgess, by the same name. And in that book, we find the character Alex saying, right before he's strapped to the dentist chair and forced to keep his eyes open, "But I want to look at the screen." He has the intentionality to look at the screen, but he's strapped down nonetheless. In this scene, Burgess and Kubrick are modernizing the dynamics of Plato's allegory of the cave. In the cave, the prisoners are forced to look at the wall. And we learn later in the allegory that they are violently resistant to being shown anything else. When the prisoner, the one that's liberated by force, by the way, from captivity and shown by violence the light of the truth, right? They make him look at the light of the truth. When that prisoner returns down below the cave to bring good news about the greater truth that he has found outside the cave, they threaten to kill him. Instead, he discovers they prefer to look at the shadows. They're likely to turn on him and kill him if he presses the point. They like their illusions. They like their shadows. They're versions of the truth down low. The educational process in this allegory, as in A Clockwork Orange, is disturbing. The prisoner is only liberated by force, for nothing else will make him change the way he directs his gaze. He has to be forced to look at the sun, and only after being overwhelmed and painfully blinded by the light is he liberated to understand the truth. The dynamics of education for Socrates involve a kind of wrenching and difficult turn from the comforting and comfortable shadows and toward the brighter unfolding and uncovering of truth above. The problem with education for Socrates is that people have everything that it takes to redirect their attention toward the truth, but they lack the gumption, the resolve, the desire. The allegory of the cave is an allegory of education by force, with unsubtle gestures toward the ultimate plight of Socrates. He died, after all, for trying to loosen the binds that hold people's attention on dancing shadows. Socrates was a martyr for truth, for education, and for the resolute dedication of those who have tasted the truth and care enough to share this flavor with others. Observe, however, what goes unchallenged in this drama. One man is liberated, initially, and forced to see the light. His transition is between two ways of receiving and appropriating data, between two modes of seeing. His problem beneath the earth is optical. He sees the shadows, but he sees them wrongly, not as shadows, but as the real. Even out among the bright and true things of the world above, his mode of seeing remains unchanged. He still, in each of these settings, gathers in the data of his eyes and makes these objects his own. He owns the sense data that his eyes bring to him. Beneath the earth, he owns the false images, and above the earth, he owns the true ones. It's a possessive way of thinking about knowledge. The transition is hard. It requires dedication and fortitude, resolve, and no small amount of force, according to Socrates. But the one who sees in the cave and the one who sees outside of it both rely on an optical hermeneutic. The data delivered by the eyes becomes seized, possessed, interpreted one way or another by the one who sees it. Consider, however, these dynamics of seeing. We view for the most part what we wish to see. We read books before us of fiction, nature, of scripture, of theology, with volition and intentionality. The visual world also gives itself over to our cognition almost instantly. In fact, if there's a gap between vision and cognition, between sense and sensibility, it usually goes undetected. I see an object, and immediately I sort it by categories, aligning it with what I've seen in countless other items upon which I've fixed my eyes. The moment of vision is a moment of possession. With enough volition, we can look at an object and permanently impress our memories, the vision that we take in. As a child, probably way too young to be disturbed by thoughts like these, but I think I was 10, and I was standing in a street in Leavenworth, Washington. There's a very Bavarian street in Leavenworth, and I remember as a 10-year-old stuck waiting for my parents to shop in a store that I was going to imprint everything I saw in my mind and remember it till the day I die. I know that makes me a strange child. And I just stood there, and I can almost picture like the waxy surface of my mind pressing the images that I saw onto it, and I carefully stared at every single thing I saw. And I was back there this summer with my family for vacation, and I instantly recognized that this is the street that I memorized as a 10-year-old. I didn't remember the way that it is, or maybe I don't even remember it the way that it was. But there was an imprint in my life. We're able to do that, right? That's me looking at a street and taking ownership of it. I'm taking possession of it. I don't ever have to go back to that street in Leavenworth for that image to be mine. I rendered it plastic. I made it fixed. And I tucked it away in my mind as a piece of me, something I own. I gathered in every single detail. Often unaware, we take in and sort the sense data of the world in a constant stream. The paradigm for perception, the queen of the senses, is vision. Smell, touch, taste, and hearing are so much less reliable and subject to interpretation and subjectivity. Consider what happens when I look at a street or an apple or a tree. The image is initially an event, a happening. That street I looked at, there were people on it in motion. The street itself was in motion. It It's alive, and it's connected to an ever-changing stream of events in the world. But in order to transition what I see from sense to sensibility, from feeling to understanding, an object must be frozen in place. Even if it's an instantaneous move, I freeze it. I re-present it to myself. I make it present to me, represent it to my mind, to my memory, and to my understanding. Like a statue or a painting or a photograph, the image is rendered plastic by my appropriation. I take ownership of this image. I could, after seeing something, close my eyes and still hold together the image with my mind. This is a universal component of seeing. It renders things outside of me present in my understanding, including books. Okay, so I'm going to set aside a little bit of boring phenomenology so I can keep talking about why I think it's important here. My first effort is to use a kind of crowbar to establish a gap between seeing and understanding, between our senses and what we do with them, between the way that we fix our eyes on books or on nature or on revelation and how we appropriate that which we've found there. So I'm trying to pry those things apart. To make sense of something, we freeze it and compartmentalize it. This happens so instantaneously in most visual experiences, we don't realize that we're doing it. The connection sometimes seems irrefutable. We would consider it nonsense, of course, if someone were to suggest that there is no coffee cup in my hand. There's always a coffee cup in my hand. But we do know this slippage, right, between our senses and how we appropriate them. We know the slippage because we see mirages, we see illusions, we have vivid dreams. We have hallucinations. Well, some people have hallucinations. We know that the slippage much better, of course, when it comes to our other senses. How often do our ears grab hold of sounds, and then we cognitively turn the noises into something of our own creation? We garble song lyrics. We mishear the words of children. We misunderstand our friends. We start wars because we misunderstood our enemies. We take the almost audible sounds that our ears appropriate, and we do our best to shelve them within the architecture of our minds, within the meanings that we form them into. My point here is that there's an in-between. This delay, which freezes time for the sake of representation to mind and memory, is sometimes just a glitch, sometimes just a slipper, brushed aside quickly and easily. But when it comes to thinking about God, and in particular, the event that is the suffering of the other person, the gap now takes center stage. Now, to be clear, I'm not the first person to suggest that we attend to this gap. Sometimes it's a chasm between sense and understanding. It's Descartes, I think, who most clearly identifies the miniature leaps that are involved in the comprehension of any sense data. After one doubts everything, after all, one's left with a series of wagers about the reliability of all of our senses. And Descartes finds here, in the in-between, in the solitary and lonely place where there seems to be only the cogito, something foreign nevertheless resides. There is, in fact, in the indubitable space inhabited by the doubting self, for Descartes, at least one idea that arises between the self and its appropriation of sense data. Anybody know what that is? It's God. The idea is confounding because although it's unavoidably present alongside the cogito ergo sum, it does not share in the obvious finitude of the thinking self. Descartes finds the idea of the infinite, the idea of God, to be beyond refutation, somehow in the solitude that precedes my appropriation and the trust of my senses. There is already an idea which is foreign, which doesn't fit, which doesn't match the finitude of the self. By confronting the gap between sense and sensibility, Descartes finds an ontological proof for the existence of God. Immanuel Levinas turned to the expertise, to the experience of insomnia to describe this undetected space between sensation and understanding. When people experience insomnia, they find that the sensible world has turned on them. We become painfully aware as we beseech sleep to come that the intentional appropriation and collation of sensations that is common in the light of day is no longer available to us. The experience that we demand, sleep, is denied us. And the very act of demanding sleep only facilitates its escape. Vision, too, is muted by the nighttime shadows. Noises in the night of insomnia arrive unbidden and unruly. In the experience of insomnia, we become aware of an assumption that we make about the fluid relationship between experiences and intentionality and perception, between an event and its appropriation. Insomnia reminds us that we are always in Plato's cave. No matter how the bright lights or noisy action of the day might obscure this. But in the rustling, silent darkness between me and myself, between sense and sensibility, something or someone already resides. The real problem with Galileo's thesis about there being two books is that it embraces the classical, modern assumption that we come to the question of God and revelation and science and nature just the same as we do to any other book. The approach is patterned after optics. We see words, images, symbols, objects, scripture, and in all cases, we take these in for the sake of cataloging them. This works well unless we encounter anything in the world that refuses to conform to this hermeneutic method. This works well unless we encounter anything in this world that refuses to conform to this hermeneutic method. Ironically, the something that lurks between me and myself, between my sense and my sensibility, may well be philosophy's principal concern. And if this is the case, if philosophy's main work is to be done on the hither side of appropriation and possession, then Plato has misled us, and Descartes has only hinted at the work that is yet to be done. Levinas suggests that we find inhabiting this world before we make any sense of it the other person, specifically the suffering of the other. Sense data that cannot be appropriated. When Descartes makes room for the idea of God, Levinas suggests that the suffering of the other person catches us before we have our guard up, before we are in the mode of appropriation and possession of our senses. It moves around, and especially before we gather either thoughts or senses. In this regard, when we think of the other person, and I mean particularly the other who suffers, we think only in the mode of response, responding to that which was present to me before I gathered my thoughts. This proximity should not be foreign to philosophers working alongside John Wesley in doing Wesleyan theology. Another way to put this is to suggest that the suffering of the other is prevenient. Indeed, for Levinas, the suffering of the other interrupts the insularity of my epistemological environment. In this sense, the suffering of the other person is not just prevenient, but also grace. It is the means by which I discover that I am preceded, that I am hopelessly captivated by the particular other whose suffering confronts me, saves me from myself. I could rise on the wings of morning and settle on the far side of the sea, but I would still find that to be me is to be the one always already under obligation to the suffering other, to the neighbor, to the stranger, to the widow, to the orphan. All of this is put at risk by the two books' approach to nature and revelation. That which I suggest is philosophy's principal concern refuses to be read as a book, refuses to conform to the quantifying, objectifying, possessing appropriation of the reader. The summons to responsibility does not wait for our attention to be directed toward it. It has always already happened. It is happening in a time before time, in a time before my time. I suspect that to labor in this place, in the investigation of the time before the sensible, we may also find ourselves able to again speak of God, and this time after the twilight of idols. The risk of idolatry, after all, is exacerbated when we turn to think of God as we move intentionally into the pages of a book, even the book. To contemplate the dynamics of radical provenience of the neighbor and of God is to turn our attention toward a way of thinking about God that is not contaminated by the idolatry of the eyes. That's all.
You have a few minutes though, right?
Yeah, I've got 6 minutes.
Yeah. Go ahead, you go. So you talked about a hermeneutic, right? The ocular is a hermeneutic. So my question is about mediation. Because when we read a book, much of the time we aren't just interested in the book, but the way in which the book mediates an other to us. Not the other necessarily, but an other. And so I wonder about how mediation fits in when, for example, another on the other side of a book is or is not the other in loving us.
The book becomes a mediation for my exposure to the other. And therefore, this doesn't have to be a book, right?
Right.
It could be a work of art,
right.
Or it could be a missive, a letter that you receive, or in some way, instead of a direct encounter with the other, you're encountering the other by way of some medium. Okay, well, I don't know that changes things much, right?
Okay.
Because what I'm trying to say, I think, in the paper, is that our senses have already been up to that business of mediating,
mm-hmm.
right? Like, in, I think my hearing's going, because I don't hear my wife well anymore. I seem to hear other people fine. But she'll say something, and I'll totally misunderstand it. Like, I'll go get her the wrong thing, or I'll go fix the wrong broken part of the house, or something like that, right? And I think part of what I'm trying to say is that's the slippage. I'm already doing that. I just with your visual senses, you don't realize how much of that, the in-between, the transition between what you see and what you appropriate. But I think with the ears, it's a little more obvious. So a book, just like a word that I hear and I take it in with my ears and try to make sense of, or the plastic, not plastic face that's before me, right? These all potentially can act like mediums or mediations. Or you telling me about your friend that I don't know and her suffering, right? They're all sort of open to the problems that come with hermeneutics and mediation.
And that those function as a kind of danger.
That's right.
That come with media.
That's right.
Not sort of media as an impediment per se.
Right, but media could be a big problem, right? So could assumptions I make about what I see on the face of the other, right? This is just like, you know, because we can pose, our faces can pose, and we can misunderstand. I think what I'm trying to say is whatever the medium, even the direct exposure to the other is available for objectification and possession. And the problem really is that we turn and face the other person just as we turn and face a book, just as we turn and face a set of scientific data, right? That hermeneutic method inclines us in that direction.
Yeah, so I guess, I'm not sure what the question is, but maybe it's why. Because as I'm thinking about, first of all, you talked about something becoming plastic in the mind. I've been learning more and more about the way that the brain works, and usually the word plasticity, when it's used with the brain, is to talk about its ability to make changes, right? And its fluidity.
Yeah, I don't mean that by plastic.
What's that?
I don't mean that by plastic.
Yeah, but taking that to the next step, when I think of a book, I don't think of it necessarily as something to be possessed, right? To become plastic. I think of it as almost something to be entered into as a world to inhabit. Certainly the visual is the way in which I step into that world, but it can happen in other ways. It can happen through somebody reading to me. It could happen through my fingers if I'm blind. So it seems. So I guess this is what I'm wondering. Why does a book have to be something so flat in a way? Or maybe I'm not understanding you, but why does it have to be something possessed? And why does creation, in this sense, have to be something possessed rather than something as a book to be kind of stepped into and through which one experiences God, like as a part of God's like larger story, something like this?
Yeah. There's good questions, and there's a lot of different ways that I can't quickly address all of them.
Sorry.
But I'm making a sort of phenomenological claim that isn't un-Cartesian about our experience of the world, right? That all the way back, like Descartes sort of makes this point that no one could ever refute, that solipsism could be right. And how can we ever refute solipsism? You might be the only thing in a jar somewhere with some wires plugged in, yet experiencing, right?
Sure.
Solipsism is irrefutable even if it's foolhardy.
If you're after certainty.
Sure. If you're after certainty or just that's right. Okay. So part of the point that I'm trying to make then is that our exposure to the world happens on top of this gap, this chasm that's between my experiences and what I do with them. And for instance, reading a book and allowing yourself to become immersed into that world rather than knowing exactly how you're reading it or taking ownership of it or already knowing what you're going to see when you turn to it, when you turn the page, or the person who always reads works of art the same way, right, is just very obviously taking a different decision to do that. And you can imagine people bickering over the interpretation of a work of art endlessly, and we've heard that happen as well. I think the seriousness that I try to bring to this question is that there's a very, I mean, it's a philosophy conference, but if it were a theology conference, I would want to talk about the way that we very easily sort of prop up a world in which we talk about God, and a world that God may not very well inhabit, right? It's a kind of, well, let's invite ourselves into this text, or into this world, or into this idea, and then we end up with a sort of idolatrous construction that everybody dresses up in ways and applauds and looks to. And I think that if we remember just how behind our experiences that we are, and the austerity with which we encounter, up closer than life itself, that we encounter God and the face of the other, before I ask the question, shall I enter into this book wholeheartedly or shall I read it quickly, right? Before that, I'm already confronted with something far more serious than art, and that is the suffering of my neighbor. So if, when we think of art, that's an easy way of thinking of something. You have a choice whether or not you can engage, right? You've already been engaged by the other as you ask that question of how to read a book. So that's why I have a problem with the two books theory, right? It's that, yes, we should read books and we should enter into that, but let's not forget that something's already happened before we've had a conversation about what we will volitionally encounter or walk away from. And that you can't shake it. That's kind of like the, you can't shake the fact that your first and foremost obligation is to God and neighbor. And that might be the same thing, right? Jesus says the second command is like unto the first.
Not identical.
Like unto, I said it right?
I know, I said just not identical.
I didn't say it.
Yeah, because you always, you were the one.
No.
I heard you.
I've always been impressed by the carefulness in scripture about the language of seeing and hearing when God is described as doing one or the other, and the nature of, Paul says it's a hearing of the gospel that saves, and no one claims that seeing Jesus saves them. You know, every time Jesus appears, he starts talking. And there seems to be something to that connected with what you're trying to say, and I was, I appreciate on that level. Another thing I want to bring up too is to the idea of, the books. I'm concerned too, and I've voiced this in other places already today, that if we don't acknowledge that when we begin to do science or theology, that we're already busy with our appropriations, so we sort of carry on a certain guidance. We're trying to guide people, we're directing their lives, right?
Sure.
And there's a sort of task that's sort of properly philosophical that tries to see how those appropriations emerge from sort of an ordinary flow of life. Sort of the ordinariness of life. And about that, I thought I ran out of time, but I thought about composing a paper for this conference about two brooks. You know, like there's two sort of ways of flowing out of this sort of ordinary life, where we start to run with our appropriations. And I don't know, I just thought I would offer those sort of kinds of observations. One, you could look at those sort of seeing and hearing in text.
Yeah,
you know, like Satan we see in a sense, and the devil we hear. This is God's sort of activity in seeing and hearing is interesting in text too, and sort of just lend that to you. I'm sorry, not really a question.
Yeah,
but I thought I would chime in.
You know? I don't have comments there. Actually without I mean there are biblical references throughout here to the seeing and the hearing. The summons in the night, the voice of God that calls in the night to Samuel, right? This is a vocalization, not a visualization. It's very difficult to make visible. And the here I am, send me, that's a huge one. And in general, the idea that one has been called, auditory really works way better. Like, because you don't really choose what you hear very often. You could try to walk around with those like Beats by Dre that pulled out the wheel, but stuff gets in your ears and reminds you that you're not the lord of your senses. Like, you don't have this power to say, I mean, you could do your best to try to turn the world inside out and hear and see nothing you don't choose, but this is artificial. But we still turn to the things that we're going to study as though that's not the case, as though we're not subject to a passivity that's prior to passivity, a passivity that's before, like, okay, I'll sit and listen. Right before that, I've already been struck by I think, obligation. So I love the biblical images for that.
Thanks.
All right.
Thank you.
Jay Russell from Claremont Graduate University and Chapin College. Give me a paper. Maybe yours has changed as well.
It's changed as well.
It is. Do you want to just tell us what the title is? Something on the two books having to do with philosophy and theological anthropology.
Yes. So,
what's that from Jay?
Claremont. So, yes, I too submit paper proposals that are basically paring down the abstract and just in the hope to try to have the longest title on the thing by the time I get there. So, my paper is called Philosophical and Theological, so I'm going to try to do some theology if I have time. Philosophical and Theological Anthropology After Humanism, Selfhood and Embodied Cognition in the Anthropocene. Many of those words will be introduced in some detail. A couple resonances already. Descartes is in the background here, Descartes' idea of being cut off from the world, so there will be some similarity there. Also the idea of the book theme of nature, except we'll just be talking about the book of nature as it relates. So this paper, again, another caveat, this paper is pared down from quite a larger project of a somewhat idiosyncratic but growing field of inquiry called posthumanism. So you'll get an introduction to it, but you're going to get a one-page rather than 10-page introduction. So hopefully it makes enough sense. Okay, so all the prefaces aside, we'll get started. Begin here with a provocative quote, as good papers do, by Theodore Adorno and Horkheimer in The Dialectic of Enlightenment. In their mastery of nature, the creative God and the ordering human mind are alike. Man's likeness to God consists in sovereignty over existence, in the lordly gaze, in the command. Myth becomes enlightenment, and nature, mere objectivity. Human beings purchase their increase in their power with estrangement from that over which it is exerted. Enlightenment stands in the same relation to things as the dictator to human beings. He knows them to the extent that he can manipulate them. The man of science, say, knows things to the extent that he can make them. In their transformation, the essence of things is revealed as always the same, a substrate of dominion. Okay. So the project of this paper is to explore the prospects for what I'm calling a post-human self in the Anthropocene, that geological epoch in which we are now embroiled in the midst of the climate crisis, as a kind of meditation on how the thought world of a particular strand of post-human thought, that of Bruno Latour, might translate into a philosophical and theological anthropology and find resonance with existing paradigms in the philosophy of mind, particularly that of enactivism and embodied cognition. Broadly speaking, okay, very broadly, posthumanists, or at least those thinkers associated with critical posthumanism, attempt to think outside of, that is apart from, hard and fast dualisms between nature and culture, the natural and the social, the subject and the object, and the human and the non-human, or two books. Latour, an anthropologist of science, philosopher, and science studies scholar, has generated much fodder for post-human thinking through his project of providing what he calls an anthropology of modernism, the birthing ground of this contemptible enlightenment humanism that the post-humanists reject. So humanism need not be discussed in detail here. If you're thinking of, you know, Da Vinci's iconic Vitruvian Man, that'll work. Or this idea of the intractable belief in a progressive teleological advancement via reason without any arcane authority, these kinds of things, classic enlightenment humanism. The reasoning Kant's self-reflexive reasoning man, yes, man, those will all work for if you have that in your mind, okay? So post-human thought, cum Bruno Latour, is that which explicitly operates with a kind of post-anthropocentricism. It seeks to move beyond humanism's hierarchical social structures and human-centric thought forms and presumptions. For my part, I hope here to survey his trenchant deconstruction of simply the modernizing concept of nature as juxtaposed to society or culture, and a strangely brazen, here's the odd part, anthropomorphic extension of agency to a great many non-human entities. Two dimensions of a thought pertinent both to the post-human ethos generally, as well as a more focused exploration of a resonance between post-humanism and certain parts of the Judeo-Christian tradition explored in the final part of the paper, which I will need to start reading more quickly to get to. In his long-developing philosophical anthropology of moderns, Latour explores what he calls the modern constitution, okay? Which constructs politically, human beings did this, a division between nature, the domain of science and the representation of things, and society or politics, the domain of the humanities and the representation of humans. Whether Galileo and Locke's strident bifurcation between the objectively existing primary qualities, real but valueless, and the subjective qualities, constructed but full of value, or Kant's forlorn and passive things in themselves, or Descartes' cold, dead, res extensa as mechanistic matter, nature becomes a container or a backdrop. The politically constructed division of nature made it a thing or a domain, an ontological territory distinct from the political and social world. Now you can think of the disciplinization of the university. Nature was the altogether really real and objective, but completely silent domain of the fact. So Latour rejects this bifurcation of nature and culture, claiming we have always lived in hybrid contexts, nature cultures, as Donna Haraway puts it. We have never had immediate, unadulterated access to the environment as actors peering in upon the unlit mechanics of a stage. Everything is composed in what Latour calls networks, a technical term, complex interagential exchanges between human and non-human agents. Modernization was the act of falsely purifying out these agency mediations and networks. Nature, as contextualized in his 2013 Gifford lectures, you know he's a big deal because he did the Gifford lecture, was propped up, nature is propped up as a transcendent category, strangely analogous to the designer god of classical theology, with one characteristic difference: universal, undisputable, external, but inanimate, as of course most animate in the case of the designer god. The demonstrable import of Latour's thought is brought into focus when placed in the context of the impetus for his recent work, that geological epoch known as the Anthropocene, a term born of the growing consensual agreement that humanity, the Anthropos, has inaugurated anthropogenically a new geological epoch, such that our creatural activity has become, according to some, the most impactful force on the global Earth systems. He invokes the figure of Gaia as the deity by which to connote this geo-atmospheric tedium in the Anthropocene. Gaia, the primordial Greek goddess creator taken up by James Lovelock and Lynn Margulis as this analogical rendering of Earth as a kind of superorganism. For Latour, the trope connotes not a unified organism, but a clash of ungoverned but linked self-advancing processes. Unlike nature, there is no uniformity, no universality, no externality, and no indisputability. In a dramatic irony, it is the once dead but now fearfully alive nature that has jumped to the center stage, ticklish and perturbed, dynamic and dramatically active, while society stands eerily dead to the reality. The flattest of characters, seemingly unable to find the appropriate affective and political response to the climate crisis. So you can imagine, we hear the crisis and we don't know what to do. For Latour, this imbrication of human social and cultural activity and the literal atmospheric and plate tectonic shape of the Earth is the foil of nature par excellence. As Bronislaw Sierzynski notes, quite fittingly, the title and the theme of this conference, quote, "The becoming geological of the human in the Anthropocene is both the end of the great stone book of nature and the aufhebung, or the sublation, the overcoming of man," end quote. What sense of the Anthropos might remain after the autonomous subject, after after the end of the presumptive solitary agent of history. The Anthropocene requires something like a geostory of agency as such. For Latour, agency is everywhere, distributed widely to humans and non-humans alike. Actors pervade networks, bound in these associative collectives, a technical term for Latour, who's building with a Whiteheadian and Deleuzian metaphysic. It is in this way that Latour commits the, in some circles, mortal sin, certainly in philosophical circles, of attributing agential reality to nearly everything. Squirrels, microbes, Venus flytraps, even just basic chemical compounds. Whether microbial biochemical action or macroeconomic political action, agency is not purged or culled or divested, as reductionists would make things mere objects. Every organism, every system of material engagements is alive, forming its surroundings to its needs, agential and a true, and sometimes eerily robust sense. The Earth, that tenuous spheroid with a thin atmospheric skin, is a broth of contingency, chocked full of a dizzying array of agents. Similar to other posthumanists, he invokes a conception of matter, material, as vivacious in a sense of inherently autopoietic, that is, self-organized, and sympoietic, that is, together organized, mutual. Such that we humans are not agentially unique, alone bearing the weight of conscious living towards death, but merely agentially complex. Latour's non-modernism, okay, so he's not trying to do pre-modernism, he's not trying to do modernism, he's trying to do a non-modern way of thinking, is precisely the attempt to normalize, that is, philosophize around, this common experience wherein we live our daily non-theoretical lives in nature-culture hybrids. While Latour prefers the term association to describe the interrelations of nature and culture and distributed agency, this kind of practice is what I call the making political of the natural, or perhaps even better, the socializing of nature. A stark contrast to the reductionist mode of, quote, naturalizing the social, as exemplified by biologists like E.O. Wilson and many others. Now, a host of historically damnable political potential charges come into view here. First, of course, is anthropomorphism, right? One thing you cannot do in the academy. Here's the question, is it anthropocentric to anthropomorphize? You might already be thinking this thing. However, for Latour, once out of nature as some dead material backdrop, our agency is not ours to disperse. Should not agency lose its mystery? It would seem, in a manner similar to Jane Bennett, a new materialist thinker, Latour attempts to avoid anthropocentrism by risking anthropomorphism. He writes, what begs for explanation in our context is not the extension of intentionality to non-humans, but rather how it is that some humans have withdrawn intentionality from the living world, imagining that they are playing on the planks of an inanimate stage. The enigma is not that there are people that still believe in animism, that other things are alive, that everything is, but the persistent belief in inanimates. The animistic impulse raises another potential charge, even worse in the academy, I might say, certainly in philosophy circles, so you gotta leave this recording when you're done. That of panpsychism, the claim that everything, all material reality, is in some sense possessed of mind, or experientially aware, conscious. Indeed, many of Latour's thinkers, Alfred North Whitehead, William James, central among them, flirt with, if not develop, varieties of pan-experiential philosophies. Odd as it may seem, however, and this may seem very odd, varieties of panpsychic perspective are gaining traction in such unlikely fields as cognitive science and even analytic philosophy. And you can think of a lot of major figures in both of those fields. 3 months ago, there was an article by a famous brain scientist in The Guardian, you know, wondering if his iPhone was conscious. So it's real now. It's not just in weird places like French guys like Bruno Latour, right? Okay, here, Latour's concept of distributed agency and autopoiesis or self-organization have two deep resonances with a growing field of positions in cognitive science and the philosophy of mind, known as embodied cognition or enactivism. For an activist, cognition, thinking, sense-making, is understood fundamentally as a making sense, a fundamental attribute that is part of all living systems. Selfhood emerges as any physical system metabolizes and is coupled with the world. Metabolization is always a self in a world. Selfhood emerges in this way, and we are bound within and forming our environment. As such, living, all living, is cognizing. And no cognitive system is a self-same autonomous agent, but rather a relational process extended into its environment. You may hear that's kind of a sexy way to talk in philosophy circles now, the extended mind thesis, the idea that the mind is not inside, as Descartes thought, but it is as much in the world as it is inside you. The self, more so, is even extensive. All lives are bound within their niche environment. And living cognitive processes are simply not computational, but also affective, that is, emotive, in the sense that they are attracted or repulsed, enacting a life of signification and value. Okay? Here's an example. Think of the bacteria, right, climbing up the sucrose gradient, drawn towards its food. He wants to say that's the same, a more basic kind of thing that we also do. That might have just scandalous. In my parlance, then, the post-human self is distributed liberally, and every such self is only itself in so much as it is bound up in relations to its environment. In this sense, the critique of nature as the asocial domain devoid of genuine agency, and the inactive understanding of self-organizing systems as essentially cognitive and relational selves, it contributes to a challenge of both the reification of the self as autonomous and the division between the human and the non-human, the subject and the object. So I want to turn here, lastly, to try to point out some resonances between this post-human impulse of Latour's system and inactivism and the prophetic literature of the Judeo-Christian tradition, particularly God's attested covenant relationship with the geological and non-human creatural agents on Earth. Okay. Skip some background stuff. One poignant example of such agential participation of the non-human appears in the second chapter of Hosea, one of the earliest prophets of Israel. Or we could turn to many other places too. I wish I could turn to all of them. Perhaps with Catherine Keller, a former keynote of this conference, we could turn to the theopoetics of the zoological whirlwind in the Yahweh speeches of Job. But back to Hosea. Mirroring the image of God's, quote, covenant with all flesh, end quote, from Genesis 9, albeit written from a different and probably older context, the prophet speaks explicitly of God's covenanting, that is, entering into a generous reciprocal relationality with the beasts, the birds, and the creeping things. It's in Hosea 2, 18 to 22. A covenant here connotes, as theologian Michael Northcott has suggested, precisely the act of distributing agency among the parties involved. So for him, the nature of a theological covenant is a distributed agency across whoever is involved in the covenant. This covenanting, referred to often as the cosmic covenant, is one in which the non-human is explicitly brought into what theologian Ellen Davis has elsewhere called a covenant triangle, a connective relationality where God has made covenant commitments and ties to the land, non-human creatures, and human creatures together, each agentially endowed, each vibrantly alive as addressed. Whether in the groans or mourning, the theologic, reference to Paul there, the theologic of the geologic and non-anthropic dimensions of creation are strangely full of life. As many rabbinic and Christian scholars have noted, this non-modern context assumes and engages the non-human as having a, quote, certain degree of inwardness or interiority, end quote, as Terence Fretheim puts it. A relational agency that God and humans do not merely relate to it as object. Adam, Hebrew word for the human, is in and of his Adama, the Hebrew word for earth. Indeed, in the spirit of Martin Buber's work, whether in agrarian practice or theological reflection, the people of the covenants related to their material world, not merely as an it, but as a thou. However, we moderns, including many of the scholars noted above just here, are quick to add that this need not commit us, those of us sufficiently modernized by the rigors of scientific purification, to some sort of strange panpsychism or vitalism. However, perhaps at the very least, with Latour and the inactivist, we would do well to challenge our claims to autonomy and to hear the call to think anew of our relation to our world. Asking as the philosopher Hans Jonas does in his The Phenomenon of Life, look, quote, at which point in the enormous spectrum of life are we justified in drawing a line, attributing a zero of inwardness to the far side, an initial one on the near side toward us? Where else but at the very beginning of life can the beginning of inwardness be located? And again, in another context, whether we give this inwardness the name of feeling, receptiveness or response to stimuli, volition, or something else, it harbors some degree of awareness, the absolute interest of the organism in its own being and continuation. So to close here. In a general sense, Latour and other critical post-humanists have opened up critical and important questions prodding this modern constitution and our orientation around freedom and emancipation that has always, in the modern Enlightenment sense, been bound to an idea of unboundedness, of absolute freedom. Ecologically or otherwise, theirs is an emancipation into our undeniable entanglements, not a deremption of autonomous subjects from a silent material backdrop, or, as our late high modernism, a reduction of the subject to the object by way of some hard-nosed mechanistic naturalism that disallows genuine agency and an organic life with, as Latour puts it, a dizzying array of final ends. That modernism just nearly doubles down on Nietzsche. Perhaps as philosophical and theological anthropology that eschews this modern divide, that does not sign the modern constitution, might go some way towards cultivating the kind of conception of the self as radically embroiled within networks of relation between human and non-human that will better enable our hearing the call, that theme again, to live in covenant with the non-human, a faithfulness that will doubtless be prophetic in the Anthropocene. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Questions?
I have a question. I loved it. I loved your paper.
Thank you. Appreciate it. I mean, it's not a widely known thinker, so I don't expect it. It's kind of probably an introduction to a lot of monkey stuff. Thank you. Appreciate that.
Yeah. It kind of sounds a lot like returning back to American Indian approach.
His thought has been, there are people that write a lot about, that find a lot of resonance between post-human thought or science studies, which you know, kind of tries to put science in some creative place, and a decolonial thought, drawing in non-Western perspectives. So Latour has not done much of that, but thinkers constantly point to him and say, hey, you should do more of this because we've been there for a while.
And in some sense, it seems you answered one of the questions raised by the last paper in the sense that, you know, he says there are appearances and we have a difficulty with sort of getting real. You know what I'm saying? But I think you're suggesting that it's the negative effort of philosophers or other groups to say, well, let's explore those oppositions. Let's explore those oppositions. And of course, the funky talk that comes out of it, you know, is a little bit weird sometimes. And you might question what direction it goes, but there's that moment of negativity sort of between what appears to us and what we acknowledge, right? And then we sort of have to pay very careful attention to those oppositions and how they come into our language. And it seems, am I on target with what you're trying to say here? And then of course, when we explode into sort of our guidance for the future, acknowledging the problems in our world, we leave the what I would call philosophy, right, and begin to be theological or moral, and we give our constructive solutions, right? Is that a fair assessment of kind of what you're recommending here, that there has to be a moment of negativity and then sort of this off haven that sort of
displays. I mean, I guess the negativity would be to be negative about the negative, I think, is what the tour says. To be negative that we have, that to begin with, we are, that there is a question between our connection to the world, you know, in his language, we're always already embodied, that yourself is not, could not be something different. You are embroiled. And philosophers just need to be more honest about it, right? That we are a part of our nature. Yeah.
You, rock, paper, scissors?
Go ahead. No, I already had a pass, so go ahead.
No, okay, and I can never articulate questions well until like 3 hours later, so.
I'll be here, it's fine.
So I'm trying to trace out the sort of prophetic and even moral dimensions of this, and how we don't end up on a kind of still sort of lonely solipsism, right? Where perhaps let us assume that, right?
Yeah.
As opposed to this modern Enlightenment constitution, that all things are cognitive, are nevertheless, is there not a void between. Because how does one avoid the anthropocentrism and the anthropomorphism of assuming that the bacteria's agency is merely a mirror of my own?
And
there's some sort of,
right,
you know, wholeness or oneness.
Right. And he wants to call it minimal. He's not saying it's not the same thing, you know, but the point is, and the Hans Jonas was trying to get at this, for us to believe that we have something categorically unique.
Mm-hmm.
Now, it may be complexly unique, right? And this is what science is trying to say. Yes, I have much more scaffolding in my neural system, you know, than that basic thing. But the basic principle is the same. It's basically that we're thinking about thought wrong, as if thought is an internal calculation. For inactivists, thought is, in a very real way, habituated action. It actually comes a lot out of Wittgenstein's embodiment. This idea that thinking is something that already is already happening, it's not a brain thing, it's a world thing. So in that way, it helps you say that for them, sense making, minimal thinking is just a basic property of living systems.
Okay.
But he wants to say it's a quite different kind than ours.
Right.
But again, the funny thing is, let's risk anthropomorphism to try to get out of thinking that we're unique.
Right.
That's what he thinks is anthropocentric, to think we're unique.
Right.
So actually, to morph, risk morphing, is to help get outside of ourselves. For him.
Mm-hmm.
It's too bad Eric isn't here. Insofar as far as what he presented, the other, the face of the suffering other, was clearly a human one.
Yes.
So it'd be interesting to think about what you're suggesting here in terms of how it might help us or direct us to be confronted by the suffering of the other that is not a human face.
Non-human, absolutely.
And maybe not a face per se.
Face of the earth, perhaps.
Yeah, face of the earth. Right. Yeah, so I mean, that's obviously not a question, but just sort of a wistful.
Yeah, I
really like the way you took that.
Yeah, he uses the language of mediation. You got it in some of the mediations. He says everything is mediated, right? We live in, we are in these mediated networks, and we just need to say, yep. Right? And so his career started by doing lab science. He was doing anthropology of scientists. Funny, right? He would be in their labs watching them do their work and say they're thinking that they're getting at something objective without any participation, but you're actually stimulating, right? You're stimulating these things, and so you're actually a part of the network, not just looking in on that unknown thing. And so anyway, I think.
Wonderful. Yeah, we're out of time.
Right.
Wonder, wait, we had a couple more. No?
Oh,
you
okay.
Can take it up with him afterwards outside.
Yeah.
I wouldn't mess
with him. He's very big. So.
Yeah. Thank you very much.
I say
and now we have Jonathan Heaps from Marquette University, and he has confirmed that the title remains the same, that the ordinance of water now.
Survive.
Wow.
Survive. I suspect that my paper was included here largely for contrast, because this is neither modern, postmodern, nor non-modern. It's decidedly medieval. My argument must, at first blush, seem paradoxical. Naturalism is justified because naturalism is wrong.
But as is often the case, the force of adequate distinction can dissolve apparent paradox. To be more precise, then, I should say that the methodological naturalism of the natural sciences is justified. But it is justified precisely because philosophical, axiomatic, we might even say dogmatic, naturalism is quite mistaken. This parallax view of naturalism springs from a largely overlooked development in Christian theology. That development asks us to think of nature, or rather to rethink nature, as neither a concept, nor being itself, but instead as a technical term, controlled by a theorem, a heuristic and theoretical notion or principle. That's a sort of slapdash definition of theorem. This development occurred at the hands, one might think the considerable hands, of St. Thomas Aquinas, and is the origin of modern naturalism to which my title refers. The theorem, as developed by Aquinas, grounds, quote, the validity of a line of reference called nature. I'll get back to where that quote comes from later. It makes nature, in other words, a theoretical instrument, an object of thought, rather than a self-standing being or Platonic ideal. In this way, Aquinas was able to make nature, for the first time, scientific. Now, there is a certain species of Thomist that will trot out the word scientific as a sidelong swipe at modern science, looking to elevate their Aristotelian notion of theoreia, derived from posterior analytics, above the messy business of the natural sciences. But I mean to argue something like the exact opposite thesis. I would claim that whether they know it or not, it has been by the light of this distinctly Thomist theorem that modern science has moved so sure-footedly in its pursuit of correlation, causation, and explanation, and, we might all notice, with diminishing reference to any revealed doctrine or theological principle. My argument is that it has so moved precisely by presupposing, however amnetically, that is forgetfully, not just their explicit notion of a natural order of contingent irregular correlations, but also this contingent order's correlated other, that is, a supernatural order. I will further argue that without at least implicitly presupposing this theorem of two correlated orders, natural and supernatural, the natural order has, in the final analysis, no intelligibility of its own. On the one hand, the ability to presuppose the supernatural, even only implicitly, provided an enormous liberation to the natural sciences, transforming the modern world and human knowledge. Natural science need not be a department of theology, nor even of natural philosophy in that antique language, but can follow its own elan of discovery, which, of course, it has. On the other hand, it is only when one remembers the origins of a scientific notion of nature in the genesis of Thomas' theorem that one can show just how unphilosophical, dogmatic philosophical naturalism has been. So the origins of the theorem of the supernatural. The theorem in question emerged in St. Thomas Aquinas' writings on grace. It is the product of a philosophical, or in the medieval language of scholastic theology, a speculative development. This is philosophy as subordinated to the theological enterprise. The theological effort by which this notion developed aims to address an antinomy in Christian doctrine. The antinomy is as follows. If God's grace is gratuitous, and so beyond our power to merit, as the Church teaches, how does its receipt not impinge on, or even obliterate, our freedom, which the Church also affirms? How can it be that grace really changes the person who receives it, but also does not thereby deprive that person of his or her agency? And yet, these twin doctrinal commitments to the reality of human freedom and to the absolute gratuity of God's grace are explicitly part and parcel of the Christian endowment, at least as early as St. Augustine. Augustine, in De Gratia et Libero Arbitrio, on grace and free will. He had plainly argued for both the reality of human freedom and the gratuity of God's grace. However, Augustine argued in an essentially dogmatic manner, quote, marshaling such an array of biblical and patristic texts, Bernard Lonergan writes, that the doctrinal claim is obviously true. In Augustine's words, not I, but scripture itself is argued with you. That humans are free and that grace is beyond any desert bars is something one assents to when one affirms the teachings, that is, the doctrines of the Church. But that affirmation need not, and for many centuries did not, include an understanding of how exactly both of these things were true without contradiction. In Grace and Freedom, which has been called the definitive work on the topic, Lonergan identified a twofold philosophical development in the work of Aquinas that's key to explicating the congruence between these two doctrines. So the idea here is, when you're catechized, you affirm the truth of these doctrines. And if you raise the question, yeah, but how do those go together? The catechism can't answer that for you. You have to do some kind of speculative philosophical work to figure out how they meet. And Lonergan's position was, Thomas managed this. Because he was a big smart dude. Both of those things. The first development required a distinction between kinds of habits, because grace was understood as a kind of habit possessed by the soul, for example, the virtues of charity, hope, and faith. The three kinds of habit are natural habits. So we might think, for example, of I have a seventh-month-old home, Oscar, and pretty much straight away, he could coordinate the muscles in his face and mouth to suck. Natural habit. What was I here? Right, natural habits, acquired habits, so I can ride a bike, but I wasn't born that way. And infused, or supernatural habits, to the extent that I'm able to love my wife with a kind of agape self-giving love, this is a gift, right? The habits of, or virtues proper to grace, then, are of the third infused variety. This tripartite distinction Thomas found more or less ready-made in the writings of St. Albert the Great and Philip the Chancellor, who I'm sure you've all read. But the second required development rested on Thomas's independent speculative achievement. He derived from this threefold theory of habits a systematic theorem of two correlated orders, a natural order and a supernatural order, and the disproportion between them. It is this disproportion itself, this relation, that Lonergan labels the theorem of the supernatural. So you're not going to find the theorem of the supernatural in Thomas. This is a scholarly heuristic apparatus that Lonergan is using to identify this structure in Thomas's thought. And sometimes he'll call it the idea of the supernatural, as in the quote below. So keep in mind that Lonergan means not just the one order or the other order, but he means the theorem is the relation between the two orders. It's algebra, not arithmetic. It's the operational relationship. So Lonergan writes, without the idea of the supernatural, there can be no satisfactory definition of grace. The dogmatic issue is indeed secure, and all repeated that grace was God's free gift beyond all deserved man, and that human beings were free. But the difficulty was to explain why everything was not grace. After all, what is there that is not a free gift of God? Right. So if you have this position of if you're defining grace by gratuity, every damn thing is gratuitously given by God. So, you know, how does that distinguish grace from any other thing? All right. Unless what Lonergan calls the entitative disproportion between the order of habits received by grace is distinguished from the order of those acquired by our own power, the problem of grace and freedom remained insoluble. After all, are not my natural powers also freely received from God? And not by any pre-existing merit. But by applying the theorem of the supernatural, that is, the disproportion of orders or used as an organizing notion, it became clear that grace consists specifically in those gifts given in excess of our natural powers, namely the infused virtues of faith, hope, and charity. Thus, Thomas could explain what remained mysterious before. Why did sinless prelapsarian humans still require grace? Grace does not just heal sin, he thought, but it also elevates human nature to those virtues that merit eternal life in God. In this way, Thomas gave wide berth to Pelagianism with a speculative position that simply was not available prior to the development of the theorem. And the list of controversies of all the different positions that people took is volumes. So to the antinomy of grace and freedom, the theorem of the supernatural provided a metaphysical frame in which the divine gift of grace liberates human freedom beyond its created limits, rather than oppressing or interfering with it. Indeed, Lonergan's point was to illustrate the magnitude of the release which formulation of the theorem of the supernatural affected in the theology of grace. Thomas was able to resolve the problem of free human agency in God's grace by situating it within a more general context, that of the relationship between the natural order and the supernatural. What Lonergan does not do, and which I explore below, is to illustrate the magnitude of the release affected not for speculation on the doctrine of grace, but on the correlated doctrine of creation. This latter development of a speculative approach to creation proved in the longer term of Western intellectual life rather more momentous than Thomas's insight into grace, which you can probably testify to the fact that most people don't know or care what Thomas
theory of creation. Okay, so creatio ex nihilo and the theorem of the natural. The effort to explain why everything is not grace calls for at least one alternative term. Dogmatically, which is to say doctrinally, this term is creatio, creation. However, like Lonergan, the development with which I am concerned is not doctrinal, but speculative or philosophical. Thomas's development of a synthetic and general theorem of the supernatural produced, Lonergan argues, a line of reference termed nature or the natural. The term nature, then, is the speculative correlate to the doctrinal term creation. Unlike its ancient Greek predecessor, this notion of nature is not simply a name for the order of being in general, phusis, but a heuristic category, and a category that fits within a speculative scheme aimed at clarifying the coherence of a doctrine. And so, much as the natural has a sort of lateral doctrinal correlate, creatio, it also has a kind of vertical theoretical correlate, supernatural. Speculatively, then, the line of reference, the natural, is derived with reference to its other, the supernatural. Right? It's just algebra. In what follows, I will briefly expand on this theoretical correlation and how it clarifies the doctrine of creation. And then I will say why I think this development is the origin for a Christian theological affirmation of methodological naturalism. That's really what I'm arguing for here, is a Christian, explicitly Christian and explicitly theological affirmation of methodological naturalism and natural sciences. But at the same time, a criterion for rejecting philosophical dogmatic naturalism. The question of grace and freedom is, at bottom, also a question about the relationship between divine and created causation. Does God's causing in you or me a meritorious habit mean that we are not also the cause of the acts that flow from that habit? Right? Does God take that agency from us by causing the habit in us? And if we are not the cause, are we really free? Thomas's answer to this fundamental difficulty, at least on Lonergan's reading, is an articulation of God's transcendence as creator that utilizes the theorem of the supernatural, this account of two entitatively disproportionate orders. Existence, on Thomas's view, is something that no finite being can cause, either in itself or in its effects. In his theology, this is a doctrinal affirmation before it's a philosophical one, though here we'll see that it's both. The Nicene Creed provides perhaps the sharpest dogmatic articulation of this. We believe in one God, the Father, the omnipotent creator of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. Thus, by both the negation and limit, omnipotent, and exhaustive dichotomy, heaven and earth, visible and invisible, absolute and universal creative causality is affirmed of God the Father. It is also affirmed of the Son, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father, through him all things were made, both in heaven and on earth. I'm mashing together a few different translations there to make the point, but it's all the same truth. The Son, as implied by exhaustive dichotomy, begotten, not made, shares in the divine nature and its creative omnipotence. Thus, it can be affirmed that the nature or substance of God is infinite, or else there might be something it doesn't cause to be. Moreover, it can also be inferred by the dichotomy between the begotten character of the Son and the made character of everything else, that things that are not God are not the cause of being, at least not primarily, and certainly not absolutely or universally. Otherwise, the dichotomy between begotten and made wouldn't carry the implication that the Son and the Father are consubstantial, affirmed in the next clause. So speculative inference from doctrinal affirmations, same three, can conclude that every created being, and so every created cause, is caused, at least with regards to its esse, its existence. Specifically, God causes the existence of every cause because only God is infinite and so proportionate of the right proportion to be the cause of being, of existence. Thus, the theorem of the supernatural, of entitatively disproportionate orders correlated in a speculative scheme, sits at the heart of a Thomist account of how God's causality and created causality fit together as primary and secondary. And so in case the analogy between the question of grace and the question of creation hasn't been clear, let me see if I can go through succinctly. So, on the side of grace, eternal life in God is absolutely beyond the proportion of human being, but human beings can merit the eternal life of the divine nature by a gratuitous gift of grace. That is, a creative communication of God's own nature that liberates human being to achieve acts of faith, hope, and charity. That is grace. Human beings, then, really are the agents of these acts, but only because they are enabled to be, liberated to be, by the grace of God. And so then by analogy, now we're on the creation side, causing the existence, the esse, of its effects is absolutely beyond the proportion of any created cause. But created causes can cause created effects. Why? Because the existence of both is caused by the absolute, universal, omnipotent, creative causality of God. Created causes are really the cause of these effects, but only because they are enabled to be by the infinite creative causality of God. In both speculative schemes, then, we have what facially might be a conflict between causal agents, that because of the disproportion between the supernatural and natural orders, turns out to be the liberation of the latter by the former. This application of the theorem of the supernatural to the question of creatio ex nihilo has a perhaps startling consequence on the speculative side. When it comes to created causes as causes, the supernatural order relates to every cause the same way. It is the source of its existence and serves as warrant for a judgment that, yes, the question, why is there something rather than nothing, has an answer. Or, to put it another way, the supernatural order accounts for that the natural order exists and that it is intelligible. In other words, that it exists for a reason. But exploring the natural order of causes need not retain an intrinsic reference to the supernatural order in every particular field of investigation. So long as the answers to these certain fundamental questions are presumed, that the universe exists and that it's intelligible, the natural order's theoretical correlate, supernatural, can be algebraically bracketed because it will apply equally to every side of every equation. God, after all, is omnipotent, maker of all things, visible and invisible. Okay, four methodological naturalism, this is my last section, four methodological naturalism against philosophical naturalism. Such, then, is a medieval theological origin for modern methodological naturalism. If it is correct, modern science can defensively investigate the order of, of our universe without explicit reference to the supernatural. So long as the natural scientist does not confuse the mystery of existence with some property, having mass, say, or energy, or position, and continues to operate on the presupposition that the universe is explicable and not absurd, then the theorem of the supernatural continues to exert its necessary influence, whether it's acknowledged or not. Doubts about the existence or intelligibility of the universe should be left to the scholarly division of labor, a bone for philosophers and theologians to gnaw, while more properly scientific issues are tackled in the lab and the field. Indeed, it is hard to imagine any scientific investigator could proceed on the opposite assumptions, unless the assumptions prove to be no more than ideological epiphenomenal beliefs. I can think of a few science writers, not of my personal relation. Perhaps more importantly, when it comes to the supernatural, philosophers and theologians should lead scientists to their labors. Otherwise, we risk trying to cram God's agency into some corner of the natural world in the indeterminacy of quantum physics or something. Instead, we ought to rest assured that the theory of the supernatural can do its work in the background, whether adverted to or not. Moreover, philosophers and theologians can maintain some equipoise when scientists express extra scientific opinions about why there's something instead of nothing, or whatever other properly philosophical or theological matter they come to believe abuts their area of expertise. But in the long run, it is better to pay no never mind to what scientists say on these matters. We need only look to what they in practice do. Do they continue to operate on the assumption that the universe exists? Do they continue to try to understand it, demonstrating their commitment to its intelligibility? Then the theorem endures. Perhaps my critique of philosophical naturalism is obvious by now. The very naturalism that is so appropriate to the modern scientist is fundamentally inappropriate in the philosopher. To presuppose the answers to such fundamental questions as why does anything exist at all and is the universe intelligible is just nakedly unphilosophical. It is, at best, the obscurantism that dodges hard questions because they are hard, and at worst, it is a dogmatic refusal to admit certain conclusions because, for whatever reason, one finds them distasteful. As Maurice Blondel tried to show more than a century ago, a thoroughgoing philosophy cannot avoid raising the question of the supernatural. Of course, two points need to be acknowledged on this. First, I recognize that the theorem of the supernatural, as I've spelled it out here, is not what most naturalist philosophers mean when they refer to the supernatural. They mean ghosts and demons and miracles. Fine. But the baby gets thrown out with the bathwater here. And though sociologically that may be the fault of the contemporary American Christianity, more enthusiastic than it is philosophically sophisticated, it is philosophically irresponsible to suppose that the whole of the Western Christian theological tradition contains no more intellectual rigor than a damn brown knuckle. There exists, I hope, that I've been able to communicate here, a notion of the supernatural that is at once rigorously theoretical and in perfect accord with the autonomy of the natural sciences, if only philosophers cared to dig a bit. The second point should be my last. In theology, to abandon the theory of the supernatural would be to flee from genuine understanding and willfully return to a muddled situation in which doctrines are affirmed in the face of nagging objections. But in philosophy, which does not have to contend with the doctrinal inheritance of Orthodox Christianity, the supernatural imposes itself only at the level of a question. This is important, at the level of a question. Though the philosopher ought not refuse to ask questions about the meaningfulness of existence or the intelligibility of the universe, the asking itself cannot decide the matter in advance. For the philosopher, the supernatural is always first a question. Heidegger called it the question of being and bemoaned how often it was concealed, unasked. It may well be that our world exists for no reason at all, and that our universe is only haphazardly and accidentally susceptible to our intellect. But the opposite may also be true, and it is the task of the philosopher, Wesleyan or otherwise, to pursue the matter with the pious impiety that will not settle for half-assed questions or premature answers. Thank you.
We've got 5 minutes. So I want to put the two of you in discussion here, if I may. What would Ronald Latour say about this?
he calls himself a pseudo-Catholic, so there's every pseudo-Catholic has Thomas Lincoln somewhere.
Yeah.
I guess that's true. I'm not Catholic. My chair of my dissertation is Catholic. He said that, so I guess. I'm not sure. I was thinking of that. Certainly, I mean, all three papers have come up with a radically different concept of nature. I think he's quite apocalyptic thinker in that he tries to draw everything into having gotten us in this bad situation with the way we treat the world now. One thing he would struggle with is the metaphysics under which Thomas is working, which is broadly an Aristotelian one, so a substance one. He uses Whitehead as his kind of, so he has a very different understanding of fundamental nature of nature. But I don't know much what I
say. Part of the difficulty there too is, I think, what gets inherited as a substance metaphysics and attributed to Aristotle and to Thomas is just a bunch of nonsense. It's not at all what they meant. It's not what they have in mind. It's not methodologically how they proceeded. And so though it had huge influence in sort of manual Thomism and all that, I mean, it was a real thing. It just wasn't what they wrote about. And so really what you have, at least to my mind, what you have in Thomas is what God, part of this articulation of God's creative transcendence that is accomplished in Thomas that the material exists for in earlier medieval thinkers, but he was able to synthetically put into one kind of view, is the idea that God doesn't just cause this thing and that thing to exist. He causes, God's wisdom is the knowledge that causes the cosmic order. Now, he had an interesting notion of like crystal spheres and stuff, right? But I think you can kind of transpose that into a modern view where things are subsequent to order, where you have a cosmic order, a set of relations, right? A set of, you could say, if you want, entanglements, and substances, beings, things that perdure for a time, emerge out of that, and then decompose out of it. So I don't think the transposition from Thomas's sort of fundamental position on divine causality with regard to nature is fundamentally incompatible with the way that people like Deleuze or Latour would want to talk about kind of complexity.
Yeah. That's good. That's your answer.
There we go.
mean, the thing that goes, that lurks in the background here that I tried to hit, that I it's not to the point of what I'm saying, is the counterintuitive thing behind this Thomist sort of really high transcendent view of God as creator is that by really absolutizing God's sovereignty, that's the thing that makes human beings free. It's not a threat to human freedom, it's the thing that enables human freedom. Because God causes all causes, including free ones. God causes all things in their motive being. And humans, for Thomas's motive being, is free. And so God's sovereignty isn't something that you have to get away from to have a liberationist theology in a Thomas scheme. It's the grass here.
Would it be, I don't want to oversimplify it at all, but it sounds like you're saying something like the Christian argument for methodological naturalism involves really allowing creation to be creation.
Yes.
Like, you know, so, I mean, yeah, that's
simple. To be the lovingly and eternally upheld effect of God's infinite being. And if that's
not
true,
but also not to be confused with God as a separate.
Yeah. Well, yeah. I mean, it can't be if it's separate from it, it doesn't exist.
Yeah.
But as irreducible, God is irreducible to creation. Yeah.
That's something that God apparently has caused.
Yeah, that's right.
God caused it to be free to choose to do
yes.
so. God's sovereignty. Thank you very much. Yeah.